Hi, everybody. I'd like to welcome you all to this webinar as part of the special series of the webinars organized by the International Academy for Clinical Hematology and dedicated to the COVID-19 pandemic emergency. The topic for the webinar tonight is about a sort of a live reporting from the ICU. And as you may guess, this COVID-19 infection has been truly a pandemic emergency and took dramatic proportions. And actually, the severe infections meet all the criteria of the so-called acute respiratory distress syndrome. And the severity usually progress, leading to rapid death of the patient. And this is why our ICU colleagues have been really on the forefront. They are the physicians, the other healthcare workers in the ICU. They have been the heroes, I would say, of this pandemic. And we are extremely grateful to them, and we owe them a lot, because these were really the fighters on the front. And for this webinar tonight, I'm very pleased and honored welcoming Professor Giovanni Landoni from the San Rafael Institute in Milan. He is in charge, actually, of the intensive care unit at the San Rafael. Before the COVID-19 pandemic, this was the unit where taking care of the hematology patient, because as you all know, the San Rafael Institute is a very strong and very active institution in the field of hematology, bone marrow transplantation, and cellular therapy. Professor Giovanni has an impressive CV with dozens of peer-reviewed publications, grants, but also patents. And he has been extremely active during this pandemic. And actually, you will see he contributed proposing solutions and ideas for new research to advance this field. So, Professor Landoni, welcome and thank you for joining this webinar.
Thank you very much for inviting me.
We are very honored. So, let me start first before going into, you know, the specific ICU issues, practices. Let me ask you my first question about, let's say, what were your ICU activities? I mean, what were before, during the last few weeks, what were the activities, your activities as a physician during the past few weeks? Can you give us a brief summary?
Sure. Thanks. Thanks for the question. So we have been working for is it 9 weeks, 10 weeks now, in a really difficult situation. So we were used to work in our nice three ICU in our hospital. And suddenly these COVID patients started arriving. At the beginning, they arrived from a peripheral center, let's say 100 kilometers from Milano or 50 kilometers from Milano, where was the area where it was more hit from the epidemics. And so we try to help these centers centralizing a few critically ill and mechanically ventilated patients. Then day by day, the number of these patients increased and patients started arriving directly to our hospital. So within a very short time, we started experiencing the possibility of a shortage of ICU beds. And so we started building new ICU inside the hospital. So we started with the sub-intensive care unit. And then we went to the theaters where there are ventilators that are somehow able to ventilate critically ill patients. But then, thanks to a private donation, we even went outside the hospital, and in 8 days, we were able to build a huge 24 ICU beds with plenty of technology inside, including an angio-city machine and an operating theater, just a few hundred meters from the hospital. So our life completely changed because the hospital was full of ICU. I mean, building the ICU is possible. Finding the ventilators is possible, but to have trained people working in the ICU, so passing from 3 ICU up to 7, 8 ICU in the worst period is really a nightmare. So everybody was working day and night, a senior and junior, and not with the nurses that you have been used to work for years and that you knew very well, but with the new personnel that just did a fast training. So it was really an important experience, both after the organizational point of view and under the clinical point of view. And so really,
my understanding is that suddenly, in a few days, you have seen a huge number of these critically ill patients who actually needed ventilation, needed intensive care. And you had to increase this capacity. Just to give us an idea, what was the magnitude of increase? Did you double? Did you triple? How did it work? And how did you manage, as you say, to find the skilled manpower to do the job? Because, I mean, I'm a physician, but I don't believe I'm able to go and work in an ICU unit as a physician. Maybe I can help, you know, moving patient or, helping and giving this and this, but that's all I can do. So how did you manage to handle this?
Yeah, let's say we more than double. So before the COVID, we had approximately 30 ICU beds dedicated to various specialty. With the COVID, we went up to 70, 60 of them dedicated to COVID, plus a few other patients. So how did we manage with the personnel? So what happened was that the elective surgery was interrupted. And so all the anesthesiologists were recruited to work in the ICU. And they usually, I mean, in Italy, we are both anesthesiologists and intensive care unit physicians. So we were lucky, at least in this aspect. And all the anesthesiologists are used to spend night in the ICU or work in the medical emergency team. And then, of course, those days we had to overwork. That was part of the job. But on top of this, What was even more incredible is that we had to work also outside the ICU, because all the hospital was a kind of sub-intensive care unit with 250 patients admitted, almost, let's say, all of them requiring at least oxygen, and up to 70 of them requiring some ventilation support outside the ICU. So I'm talking about non-invasive ventilation, CPAP. Let's call it CPAP.
So this is really impressive, actually. And we know that you did a great job despite the dramatic spread and evolution of this pandemic. But thanks to your efforts, actually, you managed actually to limit, I would say, the damage. So the most terrible thing, my understanding, and this is when these patients are worsening, and you mentioned oxygen support and non-invasive ventilation. So the major cause of death in these patients is this so-called acute respiratory distress syndrome, ARDS. So they will continue to worsen and they die. So let's move to the some pathophysiological insight. I mean, from what's your feeling? Because you co-authored with other people from your institution. You have published a lot about this maybe in probably new syndrome. Also, we call it ARDS, but maybe it's a new syndrome. So what are your insights about the pathophysiology? And I'm showing here a figure, actually, which is from one of your articles published recently.
Yeah. So you said it correctly. Let's say that almost all these patients have a respiratory failure, a serious respiratory failure that has the criteria of acute respiratory distress syndrome, and so they all require at least oxygen or non-invasive ventilation or mechanical intubation. So, of course, to all these patients, you do the routine supportive treatment that we have been trained to do for years and that we have been doing clinical practice for decades. But I think all over the world, it was immediately clear that there was something different, something strange in this atypical ARDS presentation. So it took really short time to understand that there was something new. And thanks to the collaboration with hematologists, internal medicine doctors, and any other physician of the hospital, including the coagulologist, the cardiologist, we arrived to the conclusion that this was a completely different disease with respect to the past, and we even gave it a new name. So,
we'll come to the name and to your theory. But what you summarize on this figure, and we hematologists, and our audience is mainly a hematologist at the ICH, actually you describe that after the viral entry through its receptor ACE2, starting the replication, there is a sort of a dysregulation of the pro-inflammatory signals, and all of these signals will lead to a sort of a cytokine release storm. And actually, we in the hematology field are quite familiar with the CRS because this is one of the most important or major complications of the use of CAR T cells. Genetically, you know, modified CAR T cells, the autologous one, which are approved and used in relapse refractory non-Hodgkin lymphoma, but also in acute lymphoblastic leukemia. So this first part is, I would say, quite familiar for us. And that is the reason, and you will speak about this, I guess, that you've been using in the ICU the same drugs like tocilizumab to try to control this abnormal immune reaction. But I think what you have highlighted is about also the complement activation. And I know, I mean, you're not an expert in complement, I'm not an expert in complement, but this is definitely something you alluded to. But also another important piece, which is about the endothelial lesions and the cell damage that is subsequent to the severe endothelial lesions. And this is, that bring us again to something that we know quite well in hematology, all the endothelium-related complications that we see after chemotherapy, radiotherapy. So what are your thoughts about this?
Yeah. So I agree with you 100% that you hematologists are fantastic in this field, and you understand it better than everybody. And the first author of this article is Professor Ciceri, who is an hematologist and who really had the idea and triggered the writing of this paper. So definitely there is an incredible cytokine storm. This is now very clear and documented. So you can find almost every cytokine that is increased, and almost every anti-cytokine agent has been tried or is currently under investigation. There is this complement activation, and we just published the first case report of a anti-complement drug that can really work and stop the inflammation at the beginning. And definitely there is endothelial cell lesion, because this is not just a severe pneumonia affecting the alveoli. That is the standard pneumonia and ARDS. And we are used to that, and we see a few dozens of them every year in each hospital around the world. It's a very serious situation, and you have to open up the alveoli, keep them open with the standard treatment, while the lungs recover themselves. Here we have something more. So we have the endothelial side that is affected, and that probably plays the big role in the pathology of this new disease.
And actually, this is the reason why you, of course, you are involved, and you have seen that a drug that we use frequently in hematology, defibrotide, which is indicated in severe veno-occlusive disease, is being now tested in several places in order to protect the endothelium in these patients. But I think the consequence of this endothelial damage and what you describe very nicely in your different publications, and exactly what you've been saying, it's not just about, you know, keeping the air flowing into the distal part of the lung, but then you have this issue of microvascular thrombosis. And this brings us to this, and I have put here the title of your article about the phenomenon or the theory or the hypothesis or whatever you want of this so-called micro clots or micro clotting that is actually clearly responsible of the worsening of these patients. Obviously, we know very well, and there are dozens now of publication about the alteration of the coagulation system in these COVID-19 patient, and actually thrombosis is one of the features at diagnosis, and the proportion were quite variable from one series to another. So what are your insights, or can you a little bit elaborate on this microclots theory?
Yeah. So what we saw in our patients is so to tell you how did it begin, over a couple of days we had a couple of patients dying in the ICU and a couple of patients dying outside the ICU of sudden death, and we attributed this sudden death to be pulmonary embolism because it had all the characteristics of a pulmonary embolism. And so, of course, we don't like losing patients, and we started talking to each other, I mean, what's going on? And so we started asking plenty of laboratory examination, plenty of imaging tests, and we arrived to the conclusion that definitely these endothelial lesions cause the beginning of a thrombotic process in the capillary and in the small arteries, especially in the lungs. So the acronym, I think, is fantastic. So microclots really gives you the idea of these little clots forming in the lungs. Of course, there is also a thromboinflammatory syndrome, so it's a mix of an inflammatory and a thrombotic process. So what we found was many patients with standard deep vein thrombosis, but these were not the ones who had the pulmonary embolism. And we find many patients with lung thrombosis that was isolated. I mean, there was no clear source of thrombosis around, in the venous district. And so we started doing an angio CT scan to many, many patients, because the new ICU was very technological and we didn't have to move all around the hospital infecting every place in the hospital. We just have to do 3 meters and we had the angio CT scan performed. And we started seeing these small clots. I mean, this was not pulmonary embolism. This was a small clotting formation in the lungs. This is how we arrived to it, and this is why we decided to call it microclot. So these patients have an incredibly inflamed laboratory status. At the same time, they have a prothrombotic status that is not usual, not routine. So our hypothesis, and we are now documenting and demonstrating it with several ongoing publication, is that these small clots forms in the lungs.
So this is really exciting, because actually you are bringing a very important pathophysiology piece, which I guess will have some important therapeutic consequences, because obviously if you have thrombosis, the therapy would be different. So from your perspective, in these patients who are ventilated, intubated, who have these micro clots with the COVID-19 infection, how did you manage them, and what would be your advice, and what are the uncertainties? Because I don't know whether there is a consensus in your field about this microthrombosis issues or not. Again, I apologize for my ignorance, but this is totally outside my field.
Yeah, so no, there is no consensus. So the idea that small clots can be present in the lungs in patients with ARDS is old. You can find articles of 40 years ago describing it with some angiographic examination. But definitely there is no consensus, and full anticoagulation is not the standard treatment. Not even today, not even after the publication of this manuscript, not even after the publication of many manuscripts reporting a high incidence of thrombotic evidence. And the reason is simple. Is that full anticoagulation is dangerous. Of course, it's potentially dangerous, and every good physician would like to see thrombi before starting full anticoagulation. So in our hospital, our ICU patients have been receiving full anticoagulation for many, many weeks now, not in the first few days or weeks, but immediately thereafter, yes, we gave full anticoagulation, irrespectively of the drug that we were using. I mean, we had 7 ICU and we have 3 different protocols of anticoagulation, but everybody received more than prophylaxis. And our mortality rate is already been published and is pretty good. I'm not saying it is the full anticoagulation given the 29% mortality rate we have experienced so far, but this is definitely much, much lower of what has been observed in China or in the US, where the mortality is up to 80, 90. So I think this is just a good point of discussion. But what I think we did that was great is to start a prophylaxis even in patients outside the ICU, even in patients who were walking. So a patient arriving to the emergency department and he received a prophylaxis for thrombosis, irrespectively of if he was walking, if he was if he had to stay in bed, or if he had to go to the ICU directly. Even if a patient was discharged.
Even for a moderate COVID-19 infection, you are testing low dose or prophylaxis, antithrombotic prophylaxis in this patient.
Even if the patient is going home, if the patient goes to the emergency department, is not so sick that he requires hospitalization, we send him home with preventive anticoagulant therapy. And then every patient who was admitted in the hospital, of course, was on this treatment. And every patient was investigated for inflammatory markers and for D-dimer. And if these exams were elevated, we performed an angio-CT scan in all patients to look for these microclots. And we found many. All these patients were put on full anticoagulation. And the ones where we didn't find the clots were carefully, carefully monitored. And if they didn't improve, we went on looking for thrombosis anywhere in the body, and sooner or later you find them. So this has really changed the therapeutic approach, not only in the ICU, where it is relatively easy to start a continuous infusion of low molecular weight heparin or bivalirudin, or give a double dose of subcutaneous heparin. And what I wanted to add is that we didn't have major bleeding problems. Of course, patients in the ICU can have minor bleeding because you do a lot of invasive procedures, but we didn't have bleeding issues.
So are you planning, or is it maybe ongoing, to test this strategy in a randomized fashion? Because then that will bring me to the research questions.
Yeah, so what has happened in Milano and in Italy, it is that new patients have disappeared. So let's say 7 to 10 days ago, new critically ill patients have completely disappeared. So,
which is good news.
Fantastic. It was so fast to arrive, and so fast to disappear. So these days we have, our hospital is a large hospital, 1,300 beds. We manage 270 patients at the same time with COVID. These days in the emergency department, two or three patients per day arrive. Maybe one is hospitalized and none is on oxygen. So now everything has changed dramatically. And so, yes, we are going to study different coagulative strategy, but not in my hospital. So we are contacting other centers in other countries around the world where they still have an increasing number of critically ill patients. And I think this is a focus. This is a focus of future clinical and research activities.
No, I think that brings me to what I've been always repeating in these webinars, that we have to view positive things out of this disaster. And you're alluding now to this creativity, to this innovation, to the collaboration, you know, trying to spread the word and trying to share the information. And that brings me to this question, because while I was preparing this webinar, I found a paper that you have just published in The Lancet, for instance, about new tools. And this is a photo, you know, from the article, I think, how to protect someone in the ICU, you know, because you have several patients. So give us, please, a sort of what are the research opportunities you as an ICU doc you see with this COVID-19 pandemic to advance, I think, the knowledge we have?
Yeah, sure. So first of all, ventilation. This is a pneumonia, and so different protective techniques to ventilate patients must be studied. And we are running a randomized trial of very early non-invasive ventilation in these patients. So we think that even few hours of non-invasive ventilation in the very early stages of the disease, when the patient is still on simple oxygen, can really make the difference. And this is running worldwide. And I hope we'll be able to include a few hundreds of patients and publish the results. The publication that you just mentioned was a letter to Lancet suggesting that during epidemics, if a patient has to receive oxygen in an emergency department that is not COVID dedicated, any kind of oxygen you are administering him makes the room dangerous for nurses, doctors, and for other patients. So our suggestion was, in time of epidemics, try and use the helmet. The helmet that is in this picture has been used in Italy for many, many years, but it is not well known outside Italy. So many countries definitely ignore the possibility to deliver a positive end expiratory pressure in a patient with such an helmet. With this helmet, the possibility to spread viral particles or even aerosolized virus is almost zero. So our strong suggestion was, if you have to give non-invasive ventilation, because non-invasive ventilation is a really life-saving strategy, please do your best to use helmets. So yes, ventilation, point number one, there is a lot to be studied and discovered. Point number two is coagulation. As you were saying before, we still don't know which is the best way to anticoagulate these patients. We have the new oral anticoagulants that can even be anti-inflammatory. We have different kind of heparins. We have other drugs like bivalirudin. We don't know about antiplatelets. So probably they're not so good in COVID patients. But for example, there could be even altered place for thrombolysis in severely ill patients. So the coagulation topic is definitely open to any kind of research and clinical application, especially in those countries where we're still with an ongoing epidemic and with new critically ill patients. And then point number three is the use of anti-inflammatory agents. So, I mean, for us humble ICU physicians, these drugs were almost unknown. And now we are familiar with tocilizumab, we are familiar with anakinra. Our best drug at the moment is, our favorite drug is anakinra. It's cheap, it's working fast, and has no side effects. We have a fantastic publication, we're still under embargo, but will be soon out. And all patients given anakinra had a rapid decrease of the inflammatory markers, as all the other anti-inflammatory drugs do. But these drugs does not give you secondary effects and sobra infection. And our idea and suggestion is that a drug like tocilizumab is very potent, very strong, and should probably not be used in ICU patients. It is probably a very nice drug to use at hospital arrival.
Earlier stage.
Yeah, very, very early stage. So possibly even before hospital arrival. But once the patient is critically ill, intubated, you're probably only going to increase the risk of secondary infection. And the other research opportunities are everywhere. I mean, working within the medical emergency team was a real experience. So to manage together with the world physicians, hundreds of critically ill patients outside the EU, outside the ICU, was inspiring. And so we started in Italy, but now everybody is doing it around the world. We started, for example, pronating patients. So we put them face down. And the saturation immediately improves, irrespectively of the status of the patient. The patient can be on spontaneous breathing, can be on non-invasive ventilation, of course can be on invasive ventilation, where pronation is already a fantastic and documented evidence-based medicine technique. And working in an Italian hospital during the peak of the epidemic, you saw dozens of patients in the prone position, and this was done to increase their oxygen saturation and even their psychological status improved because of the improved oxygenation. So I think multidisciplinarity was a fantastic discovery, and I think this disease gave us the opportunity to learn a lot. I think, first of all, that a patient who arrives in the hospital today receives a better treatment than what we did at the beginning. Now we have seen more than 800 severe bilateral pneumonia, and the few new patients are definitely managed in a better way. And if you want to see something positive of this epidemic, I think that every critically ill patient in the future will be better managed thanks to what we have learned one each other inside the hospitals.
Well, I think you made a wonderful conclusion. I think that even in the hardest and darkest times, what you've been telling us, we can generate a new knowledge. We can apply evidence-based, we can collaborate, we can accelerate and bring new advances. And this is why we are extremely proud of you, ICU guys, and we are extremely grateful. So that was a very inspiring and exciting webinar. Thank you very much, Professor Landoni. And thank you all for attending this IICH webinar. Maybe if we have a few minutes, we'll take some question if Professor Landoni would stay with us. So thank you very much. And wherever you are, have a good night, have a good day, or have a good morning. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.